welcome back, and thank you for joining us for this second part of the day. This is day two of our AdobeLive.com web stream on illustration. And this is day two also for you, Maria Grönlund from Denmark. Mm-hmm. And we will be illustrating for the next 2 hours using Adobe Illustrator. Maybe before we start, we can just go over very quickly what we did yesterday.
Yeah, yesterday I was showing how I could draw drawings and logos using the Fibonacci spiral, mm-hmm. and creating the guide using the Fibonacci sequence.
Yeah, and that's awesome. If you want to see how Maria created the Fibonacci guides and the circles that he then used to create the illustration of a bird. What bird was it again?
A bee eater.
Okay,
yeah.
The bee-eater bird. Very colorful bird, yeah. Like the background we have right behind us right now. Very colorful. Mm-hmm. And basically, what she did, she created all the circles, like taking them from the Fibonacci sequence, and then using those circles to have them in proportion inside of a drawing. It was super interesting. So if you want to watch the replay of that, inside of the Adobe.com Live interface, there's a button down there that actually lets you see exactly the replays from the previous day. And before anyone asks, all of these videos we're making, all of this live streaming, will be available for replay. So don't worry if you missed the beginning, you can watch it later, okay? But very importantly, come here to AdobeLive.com and join the conversation, because that's another really cool thing that we can do during the live during this live session. You guys can ask live questions to Maria, and Maria can interact directly with you.
Yeah.
And there's also going to be a few things that we're going to be doing apart from answering questions that anybody might have. We're also going to be raffling out prints, autographed prints that Maria will autograph, and we'll send those out to two lucky winners today. We had two lucky winners yesterday for the bee eater illustration, and today we will have two lucky winners for a new illustration, which we'll discover in just a second. And then, of course, there's also the AdobeLive.com 3-day competition. We're already on day two today, so you have today and tomorrow to actually present your work using the Adobe Live hashtag. And all of the rules are written down there there's a little button for that says contest. Okay, so if you want to know about the contest, that's there. And looking at the little buttons, there is a chat button, there's a schedule button, which is so cool because it's actually adjusted to your own time zone. So there is no more fiddling around with, oh my God, what time is that in London? Or what time is that in Mexico City or in the Philippines, you know? So basically it's all scheduled very precisely down there, and you can even put it into your calendar. So if you wanna make sure you don't miss Maria tomorrow, you can already put that in your calendar. And there's the replays, and there's also the speakers button, which is really cool because we've provided links to portfolios, to more information about the speakers if you want to know more about them. So Maria, why don't we dive in and actually see what we're going to be working on today. Let me just change the screen here, and yeah. Whoa, what is that? That looks like a prehistoric bug or something.
So what I'm going to share is, we talked about how I learned to use Illustrator and also Photoshop and InDesign. Mm-hmm. In fact, I decided to learn one tool a day, mm-hmm. and I'm going to share some of how that would look like. Mm-hmm. So this is actually the first tutorial I made many years ago.
Okay. So is this something that you did straight away? Did you feel like you had to share your knowledge from the very beginning? Or is this something you slowly came into?
So this learning process is without any expectation to the outcome. I just play around, and mm-hmm. and if I find something interesting, I make a tutorial. Mm-hmm. So for when I was playing around with this, I had very little experience with Illustrator, mm-hmm. and I had this idea of Illustrator was something with drawing straight lines and defined edges, and mm-hmm. and when I came across this result that looks a bit like fur and feathers, mm-hmm. I was very surprised, and mm-hmm. I thought that would be interesting to share with others.
Where do you share your tutorials?
On Facebook on Behance.
On Behance,
can,
yes.
Yeah, mm-hmm. you can go to my portfolio and yes. find several mm-hmm. tutorials if you like.
Okay, so Behance is that yeah. where Maria maintains her portfolio. So that's one very good place to find those tutorials. And I've been there lately, and there's really many things to look at. And it's so great that you know that you share these things, because I think you know many people say, yeah, but I don't want to share my tips and tricks and things like that, because this is you know it's my work and.
I feel quite the opposite. Exactly. It's so exciting to see uh-huh, what uh-huh. others can mm-hmm. come up with using the same technique. Mm-hmm. Various results pop mm-hmm. up.
Yes, it's crazy, because when Maria tweets out a new tutorial, then there's like dozens of mm-hmm. people who actually send in their own version of what they created with any specific tutorial.
It's so amazing to see the results. Yeah.
All right, so let's get started. Did you give this guy a name?
No, I just called it Little Fellow. I didn't know
Little
what.
Fellow, okay.
Little Fellow, yeah. So, well, I shared it because this is something for me at that point. It was something that I didn't expect to see in Illustrator. It was sort of accidental. I came across the result. So one of the things I did when I was learning Illustrator was learning one tool at a time and then combine the tools. And when you start to combine the tools, something surprising start to happen, rather than when you're just drawing circles and squares, mm-hmm. when you add effects and things like that. That's really where the surprising thing starts mm-hmm. to happen. So
I think that's a very, very good point. I think it's very important to know about all the tools in any given software, just to know about them. You don't need to necessarily know exactly how to use them right away, but I think the important thing is to know that there are specific tools that do specific things. And the day will come when you will have a project, where you have an idea, where suddenly you say, hey, I saw that tool in Photoshop, I remember, and then you would use that tool, or combine the tools, like you just mentioned, which is even better.
Yeah. So, you'll be surprised. This is the base for this is just a couple of strokes, simple strokes that is applied color. And the tool that really does the trick, we'll find over here. It is a section that is not so often used in Illustrator, mm-hmm. which I think is a shame because it's really interesting. Let's open it. Under the width tool, which is by default mm-hmm. the tool you see here, you can open the take off a whole section of tools here, so you can easily access them. The warp tool section, you might have seen the Radiolarian tool on mm-hmm. Behance.
Yes, maybe we can have a quick look at it. Let me see, Behance. What was it called? Radio? No. Let me see if I
might have it open.
Very slow internet here. See? Okay, you have it open? Okay, great. Oh. Okay, you have it on your screen.
Yeah.
Perfect. My computer is misbehaving. Yes, your screen is being shown right now.
Cool.
Yes, here we go.
Yeah. So this is a project that was not meant to. I was not aiming at making anything pretty, just trying out the warp tool section. And for this project, I applied it to a blend mm-hmm. object. You don't have to use a blend object. You can use basic strokes, a circle, or whatever you like. Let's see if I can scroll. No, that really doesn't matter. You can find it on Behance if you like and follow it.
Maybe if we go to the page itself.
Is that a link? Oh, okay. Still learning to use this computer.
Maria's new computer.
Yeah, my new computer.
Well, you can go check it out on her on her Behance page.
Yeah. So for this, let's just. When you're using the Walk Tool section, you need something to apply it to. You can, it's not a standalone tool, so you can. I started out drawing a line. Let's just start here. So I wanted to apply transform because.
So this is a line. This is not a rectangle.
A simple line
with the line tool.
10 point in thickness and approximately 500 in length. It doesn't have to be very precise. So under effects, distort and transform, there's a tool called transform. So
I love the transform tool.
Yeah, it's so easy to, if you want to make many copies. I want to, I want 7 strokes in total, so I add 6 copies. We can have a preview, and I want them to have a distance of 25 pixels. So it's also going to be very precise. If you like to have a precise result, this is also a nice tool. There you go. Yeah.
That's a very good way to duplicate things in Illustrator using the transform panel or palette. And is this a panel or palette? Panel. I don't know. The transform thing. And yes, and this is also something that you can do with the appearance panel, right? That you can like apply various transformations from.
So if you open the transparency panel after you applied this transform effect, it will appear here, and you can double click on it, and you have the palette opening again, and you can alter the values if you want less distance or more copies, and you can even, as you can see, I've applied it twice because I've tried the tutorial before I came here just to make sure it worked. So. Yeah, you can even rotate and all sorts of things, and you can this tiny little. You can decide where the transform is origin from. But
maybe later, if we have some time, I can show a little bit of what I do with the transform palette and just a circle. You know, you can make really cool guilloche effects and stuff like that. So
that
let's see if
nice.
We have time.
Yeah.
Yes.
So when the transform effect is applied, you really just have one stroke here. If I go to outline view, you can see there's just one stroke. So if we go back, if you want to have access to all the strokes you'll see here visually, you have to expand, go to object and expand appearance. And in the appearance panel, we can see that now it's a group. It's not. You don't have access to the transform effect now.
No.
You have to undo and go back if so. So we can go to the next step then. I'm just going to copy it to go back. On page 2. Copy.
So Gerjan is working in Illustrator right now as well.
Oh.
Yes. Tony Morales said it's a good initiative from the Adobe company.
So now we have a base. I have a base I can work on. I can apply effects. The transform was an effect. And I'm going to apply a new effect Just a second. Under warp. Here we go. Flag. And I'm going to set it to 45. Let's see. Just so you could have drawn this with the pen tool.
You could have, but
not so precise.
No.
It's quicker. This is faster.
Yeah, this is. I mean, the warp tool is something that that's so useful when you do waves or flags or things that have to move in a warp. And there's so many different warps. This is the flag warp, right? But there's like
tons of
others, like arcs and bulges. And
sometimes it's a bit difficult to predict the result.
Yeah.
Just try it out and use the sliders. Just we can try a couple. So again, the effect appears here in the appearance panel. I really like that because then you can adjust again. So I'm going to expand this again because if I go to outline view just like before, you can see it's really still straight lines. So I'm going to object again and apply appearance, expand appearance.
There and now, if we go back to outline mode,
outline view,
boom,
yeah.
It's
boom.
The object itself.
That's nice.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to ungroup before I use the warp. So, yeah. So yeah. Now it's ungroup. What's really interesting about, I'm using two sections now. I'm using the effects you find in the menu. We have used two now.
So yes, the warping
and
transformation.
So the effects are very precise. You always get the same result when you are entering the same values. And you also have access to alter them. So even though the effects is very similar to some of the tools you find in the warp tool section, it works slightly different because the warp tools are applied sort of manually with the mouse. You drag, click and drag over or just click. So it is not precise in the same way, which sometimes good, sometimes bad. It depends on what outcome you're looking for. So,
yes, like for example, we've just spent 2 hours with Dan Mumford, and Dan Mumford is like freehand drawing. So that's not so precise. It's more like like a direct application of a stroke.
Yeah.
And so basically, this is something we talked about yesterday, I think, as well. Like, there's. Somebody asked, so do you apply the Fibonacci sequence to all of your designs now?
No.
Of course not. But there's so many ways to do things, like to be precise, to be a bit less precise, to prepare, your graphic elements in the way that's more comfortable to you and that makes more sense for the final outcome.
Yeah, so one of the benefits about the warp tool is you can make a more organic result. But also, you can say the downside is it is unpredictable. If you want exactly the same result, it's almost impossible, which is kind of risky to do this live stream because
mistakes are part of life, right?
So I'll do my best to get the result I'm looking for. So in what you can do in the warp tool section is you can either double click on each tool. We're going to use the scallop tool.
The scallop tool.
Scallop tool, yeah. It's not used very often.
I wonder where that term comes from.
Scallop, what it means? I don't know.
Yeah. We'll figure it out sometime. Maybe somebody in the chat knows. Scallop.
Scallop.
Maybe somebody can Google that and tell us what scallop tool means.
No. They will find
the scallop tool.
Scallop tool. So So either double click. Another thing you can do, you can just click directly on your artboard. Just one click. No. No. Okay. So I set the dimensions. So depending on the values here you're setting, the result is really going to vary a lot. Mm-hmm. So if you're aiming for the same result, do remember what settings are, take a screenshot or write down or whatever.
So basically you're now changing the width and the height of the is it like a brush dimension?
Yeah, yes. Visually it looks like a brush you're applying, and then it's applying the sort of a kind of effect you're applying manually.
The intensity of the scalloping.
Yeah, so the more intensity you're setting, you can, let's see, you can go all the way to 100 or just one. The more it's applied. And you can also set the complexity in detail. I would recommend start with low values because it's going to get really heavy and both for the computer and very detailed.
It's a good tip. Always start, you know, when you're trying out a new panel, always start with low values.
Yeah.
Because sometimes it happens that you put like high values and then you say, and then never use that tool again.
You'll get that spinning pizza that's going on forever. And so we can start with a low value just to try it out. And as you can see here, the first brush effect anchor points is dimmed. So if you toggle off one of these down here, the other options, it will you cannot access it. So you can combine two, use one or two at the time, but not all three. So I'm going to use it.
I have to admit, in all those years that I use Illustrator, I've never gone into that scallop tool options window. No, never.
You will now.
I will now.
Yeah. So again, the result varies really a lot. We can try it out just for fun. So this is the combination I would like to use, but let's see what it looks like. So we have the line selected, and I'm going to follow the middle of the group of the strokes now. Click from left to right, click and drag. So, let's just give it a try.
Scallop, to cut into curves or notches. Thank you, Steve.
No.
So.
That's what it is.
Yeah. And as you can see in the appearance panel, you can't undo or reset the values. It's applied directly.
Okay.
So if you want to keep your original lines to give it a try, other values, then make a copy. One of the benefits here is you can apply the same again, so you get more intense result. And you command H to hide your selection so you can better see the result. Looks a bit clumsy, but let's try some of the other.
Okay, Gurjan. Okay, Gurjan says it doesn't have the warp options anywhere in Illustrator CC, but they are there. Let's see. Maybe under Window. Is it under Window? Is there a way to access the scallop tool? No, just show him on the menu on the tools bar again. I think that's the only way to access it. This is it.
Yeah, under the width tool is by default what you see in the panel. Over here, just below the drawing section, you'll have. There you go. And if you want to have, as I mentioned before, if you want to see all the warp tools, then click on the small arrow and. Yeah. There you go.
All right. Yeah. Let us know, Gurjan. It's under effect. Yes, it's Adam Bentley said it's under. It's under below the width tool. Yes.
Yeah.
Hey, Ton. Nice to see you here in the chat. A long, long longtime friend Ton Fredericks from the Netherlands. Yes, Ton is the illustrator expert, I would say.
Do you know Ton Fredericks? Have you ever met Ton Fredericks?
No, I might know his work when I see it.
He used to work for Adobe. And he's now in enjoying
Ton,
his
yes,
pension.
Yes, of course I know
yes.
him.
You know
yeah,
Ton.
Course, okay. yeah. I haven't met him, but I know.
Okay.
Him
yes,
him, yeah.
Ton.
Yeah.
Good to see you here. Thank you for joining.
Yeah. So another thing I want to mention is now I'm using the touchpad on my laptop. If you're using a mouse or a vacuum pad, the results will vary also.
Effect. Oh, because does it apply pressure? No.
I don't think so, but for some reason, so when you're applying effects from the menu, the speed of it doesn't matter. But when you're using these warp tools, how fast you're dragging.
I get it, yes, yes,
so
yes.
If you. That's him we can see. No. Let's just adjust so we can see. Now it's very low value. Let's set it to 50 and try again. So if you're going really fast, it should. It usually becomes
more complex all the time.
Yeah. So it's a bit like a magnet. It follows the anchor points or whatever you are setting in the panel is following the mouse, the cursor.
Can we see that maybe in outline mode?
Yeah.
Maybe we can. Okay. Now we see it that way. But when you brush it again, maybe we can really see how it follows
It looks a bit like magnetic dust, you know, the children's toy when you...
Magnetic dust. I haven't seen magnetic dust for ages.
You know, back in the 80s.
Nice.
So, in principle, I could drag the other way also, or whatever. And then it would turn around and follow it the other way. That's really one of the benefits of these tools. You can apply it to just parts of what you're just a corner.
So there is an option to apply pen pressure when selecting the intensity. So if you use a tablet or some pressure sensitive device to draw, well, thank you. Thank you, Amit.
Yeah.
By the way, since we're here, just a quick shout out in the chat. If you guys just want to tell us where you guys are from. Yes, so we have a little idea of, who joined us today. Ah, Gurjan, it's named differently and has different position in my CC. What have you done with your CC? All right. Let's see. Well, it's just a second where everybody comes from. Elias says, go, Maria. Adam Bentley. Oh, okay. Did you change your toolbar?
Nope.
Weird indeed. Algeria. Hello, Elias. Alabama, India. New York, San Francisco. Indiana, Italy, Iowa, New Hampshire, Bangladesh, Ohio, Qatar, Algeria, Texas, Netherlands, Florida, Ukraine, Colombia, Sweden, San Diego, Mexico, United Kingdom. Now it's going too fast. I can't read anymore.
Wow.
Serbia. But I think we have people from all over the world. So thank you. Thank you for joining us here on AdobeLive.com. Remember to get the full experience of these streams that we're creating for you. Go to AdobeLive.com if you're watching them on YouTube right now, because there's a whole experience that we've prepared for you with access to the chat, with a schedule of upcoming shows, access to the replays, the information about the speakers, and even our 3-day contest.
Yes.
And talking about contest, what time is it? Oh, in about 30 minutes, we're going to be raffling out here in the chat a print of whatever the final result will be today. We're gonna print it out and we're gonna give it a name, right? And we have it signed by Maria and shipped to you if you're the lucky winner. All right, let's go on.
Yes. So yeah, let's just set the correct values. I'm checking. Loose. Yeah. I'm usually using a vacuum pad, so it feels a bit clumsy here. I'm going to apply the warp three times, so I get really detailed. So not most elegant, but that is. And you can. I've hide. The selection is hide, so we can see the result, and you can alter the stroke width. I'm going to copy and move on. So here we are. Yeah, this was the result I made from home, so you can see. Yes. Yeah, it's unpredictable, but it's kind of the charm about it. You might stumble upon something that's really very different and interesting and take you in a new direction. So
absolutely.
So it can be time consuming in that way.
Until you get it just right.
Yeah.
And also, wouldn't it be cool if people here watching the live stream would actually follow your steps in Illustrator and maybe also like send us your interpretations of the little guy? No, what is little fellow?
Little fellow.
Little fellow.
Mm-hmm.
If you're sharing work with us, please use the Adobe Live hashtag on Twitter. Or Instagram as well, right? Michael? Both Instagram and Twitter, okay. Yes.
So I've worked on the form, the shape now. So I can start to work on the colors. So, I've been cheating. I've made some colors prior to this. I have my swatches panel here. So, for these next steps, it's good to have your gradient panel open. You can find it under window. Gradient, you can see there it is, and you'll find the swatches here as well.
Somebody mentioned in the chat one way if you get lost in the interface but you remember the name of the panel, just go to the help menu and start typing the name of what you're looking for.
Search.
Like start typing gradient. Then it'll show you all the various menu items and it'll show you where it is inside of the interface.
Cool. Yeah.
So if you ever get lost in the weeds, that's where you find the information, the help menu.
Yes.
And wouldn't it be cool if in the help menu we had a little button that says Adobe Live? Right?
So, let's see. So, one of the things about when you're applying a gradient to stroke is you can manually, you can't adjust the direction, but you can adjust it here. So it's slightly different angle.
Well, and that shows. Okay, so basically, you're changing the angle of the stroke. Like, imagine if we have a straight line,
The angle of the gradient applied to the stroke.
Yes. So if we have a straight stroke, let's imagine a straight stroke, you would only be able to see if the stroke was thick, right? That you actually move the gradient. Instead of going from one point to the other, it like actually, you can, I mean, it's also a very good way to make a stroke on a thick line that goes through the stroke.
Yeah, let's just give it a try. And so I make the stroke very thick so we can see the result.
Yeah.
20. So right now the angle is 0. And if we change it to 90 degrees, you will have the green in the bottom and the gray in top. And if I press the G key for gradient on the keyboard, you will see this circle with a line through it.
Yes.
You can't tells you you can't alter the angle mm-hmm. manually. So
that's kind of weird.
Maybe in the future.
Maybe in the future, yes.
But I have a little trick if you want to do it manually.
Okay.
Okay. So you can, with the, we have it selected, I can press Shift X, so the gradient is now as a fill, and we have the fill in front.
Okay.
Now I can alter it. This, and then I press Shift X again.
Yes. Shift X.
Yes, and now we can see that
the gradient
the angle,
is yeah.
angle is applied. To
That's a very
the,
nice tip.
Yeah, simple. So, let's see. I'm just going to control click to see it's a group, so I'm ungrouping.
So Ken Latman says, why don't you draw a straight line and let's just draw a straight thick line.
Yes. Boom, boom, and
thick.
Very thick. So,
okay, something like that.
Yeah,
and then change the angle of the gradient.
Yeah, if I press the G key now, mm-hmm. we get the not possible mm-hmm. sign here. So, yeah, when you're changing the color of your stroke to fill now, it's
no, it
invisible.
Wouldn't work. Yeah, no, that wouldn't work
no.
here.
But
let,
still,
we can, let
you can still. Be sure to have the fill in front, and then you can change and go back.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't remember the
thickness
stroke
of
thing.
The line,
you have to
yeah.
apply that again. But and
but I guess you can also go into the angle of the thing and just with your arrows like
yeah.
just cycle through it.
If you shift click and use arrow up and down, it
mm-hmm.
will change the value
okay.
with +10, -10 to the nearest
okay.
10.
And that's how it changes. You can see
yeah.
it changing live.
Yeah.
On AdobeLive.com.
Exactly. Double live.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yes, and this is something that's isn't that quite recent in Illustrator that you can apply gradients to strokes?
To strokes. Yes, I use it a lot. It I think it's from CS6.
Maybe. It wasn't always there. So
yeah.
it was very very welcome when users could start doing it.
Yeah, if you have a version of
Tan would know. I know that Tan would know exactly. He probably knows the date when the feature came in into into Illustrator. Yes.
2 p.m. Friday. Yeah, if you have an older version of Illustrator than CS6, you can expand the strokes and then
yes. It wasn't perfect.
No, but it's possible. You're not
Land Point Win says, oh my god, that's awesome.
Yeah, yes. So, outline view, we can see that it starts to look like fur
mm-hmm.
now. So, to add a little depth, I will change the transparency mode.
Of the various lines.
Yeah, you'll find mm-hmm. it over here. And you can also find transparency under window. And if we use multiply, you see, but it's very close to the result
mm-hmm.
I was aiming for. And adjust the stroke width until you're satisfied with the result. So, you know, you can still use the scallop tool and just hit a few lines
mm-hmm.
if you want some. It looks like it's
Does it also unscallop if you press the Alt key or something? Does it do the opposite of scalloping?
Opposite of scalloping. What would that be?
I don't know. Putting it back at how it was.
I don't know. I know. Nothing
See?
Happened. Ooh.
Okay. This changes the brush
cool,
size.
Yeah.
The brush shape. Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. So let's just go on scalloping that shape.
Scalloping. I think it looks really like fur when it's not too strict and when it's, you know, hit a few. And if you're not satisfied, just undo a couple of times. Try again.
Oh, Tom Fredericks doesn't remember. No worries, Tom.
All right.
All right. So this is basically, this is the work method for mm-hmm. making something fur.
Okay.
Fur-ish. So you can just use it on, I like to use it on a group of strokes, so you have a lot of anchor points,
mm-hmm.
so you get more details. You know, if you use it on, if you had a square, that's just, you only have 4 points, and you use a scallop on it. You don't get so a detailed result.
So the more points you have, the more
details.
The more. What was the name again? The scalloping.
Scalloping. Yes.
Awesome. And then you like in the final one, you put little two eyes, right, on your little fellow.
Oh, you. Yeah, so I found out you could apply scalp to lions, a group of mm-hmm. lions, and you know, the line segment tool is here,
mm-hmm.
and if you click, by default the line segment tool is the one that is selected when you open Illustrator, and as you can see there's a tiny little arrow in the mm-hmm. right lower corner. That means you can also open this panel and have it separate from the rest of the tool, so you have access to it. So this is really something I did when I was learning Illustrator. I took one section at a time and tried all the mm-hmm. tools in each section to see, you know, compare them. That mm-hmm. they're doing much the same but slightly different. So for some reason, there's also some tools here that is not very often used.
Okay.
So how many has used the polar grid?
Ken Latman is just asking, would you then flatten the transparency to maintain those colors in order to put the creature on a different background?
Ah, good question.
Hmm.
Ah, that is a clever question. Because...
Tom Fredericks, correct. Yes. CS6, gradient on stroke.
Yeah. So we have this, it has this group of strokes. We have applied multiply transparency,
mm-hmm.
but what you can do, you can say knockout group, isolate blend. So if I make a, let's see, it's like, so I'm going to deselect and, deselect. There you go. So if you press D on the keyboard, you will have by default white fill and black stroke. And I'm going to press Shift X to get the black fill and no. So let's just see. Let's just put a colored background behind this.
Little fellow.
Right. So Command X and Command B. You put whatever you have in back. So you can see right now, we need to do something because it's disappearing. So
because it's on multiply.
Yeah, it is. So. Let's just uncheck all this. And group. So now I should be able to. You see, now the group
mm-hmm.
as such is in normal mode,
okay.
but each stroke is in
mm-hmm.
multiple
yes.
mode. So I should be able to.
Ah.
Yeah, there you go.
It looks luminescent.
Yeah. You can change it. Maybe you have a less dark. Background, so it looks.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
Yep.
So that's how we do it.
That's how you do it, Ken.
Mm-hmm. So.
I could see many applications of this technique, Ryan says.
Oh, mm-hmm. nice. So yes, that's really one thing when you're learning this way. You're not calculating a result and then constructing it. on the go, you sort of say, oh, this could be used for this or that. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to show this later on also. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
People are saying, more Maria.
Oh, circles.
Yeah. So just like the we sort of use the transparency.
Transform panel
effect. Yeah, for creating multiple strokes, you can make multiple circles with the polar grid, which I do believe is not used very often.
No. And let's see in the chat how many of you use the polar grid. I think we're going to see a lot of silence here. I could have made use of this tutorial last month. Had to make peacock feathers. Oh. Right? Yeah. Yes, glue.
So just like the warp tools, you can also double click on the polar grid tool when it's selected and adjust the values. So I can set the size of
one. Can you maybe show how you did this circle thing? Like all the concentric circles? With the transform panel maybe? Did you do it with the transform panel?
No, I'm going to use the polar grid.
Ah, okay. To create these circles.
Yes.
Rufus.
So... yeah, let's just say the width is what it's set to here.
Maria Francesca Girelli says sometimes to make skirts.
She uses the polar grid.
I remember we had a conversation with Maria Francesca here because I think you're from the fashion industry, right? And there were some things that you were showing that she was using in her. Designs in our fashion designs. I think,
yeah,
yes.
When you lay out a skirt flat on the floor, it would be a concentric circle, of course. Yeah.
Maybe.
So you can make a skirt template.
Stop spoiling the surprise, Rufus. Okay.
Shh. So you have to, maybe it's just because my English not so good. So when it says concentric dividers, what does that mean?
Concentric dividers.
Yeah, so the concentric dividers is the one that goes inward, all the circles you see here. Whereas the radial dividers, let's just, what you can do, you can actually just click on your artboard. And it was you will not only adjust the values, you will also see the result when you click OK. So I don't want any radial dividers, which would be strokes pointing out from the center.
Maybe we can show the radial dividers.
Yeah, let's just see. No. I have no feel and no stroke, so of course you can't see it. So let's give it a try. So radial divider 6 D. So there you go. So yeah, I like to use I also use the polar grid when I'm making color wheels. When I'm making a logo presentation, a visual identity, you want to show the client you can use each color in percentages. And for those who attended yesterday, I showed how you can use the live paint tool. Let's just check
let's quickly make
just very quickly.
For those of you who want to see how to more in-depth live paint explanation from Maria, watch the replay from yesterday. So day one.
Yeah, so we have a polar grid. I could press K and now this is a live paint group and I can fill in colors and each section could be in let's just put something in right here. No, I'm going to use a global color.
Okay.
And I'm going to explain why. Let's just apply it to one section here. And also you can actually click and drag to pour in color. And Shift L. I'm going to select this, and if I click Command H, we can see they are selected. So when I go to the color, you can see it's 100%. So I want to show the client you can use this color in 80% or 60%, as long as it's the same values, basically the same swatch. So let's say 80%. It's turning lighter and lighter. Again. So I make a color wheel this way.
Yes.
Yeah.
Makes total sense.
Yeah. So if I want to show the same effect with another color, I just click on another global color. No, didn't work. So that was a short introduction
okay.
how you can use the polar grid for a color wheel also. So I'm going to make a hat for the little fellow.
Oh.
So my new discovery, the scalp tool, I want to explore what can I use it on. So now I'm trying on a polar grid to see how that looks. Just make sure the values are a little bit funny now because we changed. This will do. Okay. So it's selected, and I'm going to click and drag again. Ooh, yeah. So if we go to Outline View, we are almost reaching the result that I was aiming for. Again, it looks a little bit clumsy with too fat, maybe. You can turn down the thickness of the strokes. So, yeah, remember you can apply it multiple times, and then undo if you...
Jonathan must be a fan of yours because says that she used this effect in her Exotic Machines logo found on Behance. Did you? No.
I don't think so.
No.
But maybe.
For color wheels. Okay.
Oh, yeah, right,
yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I did. Yes.
See, people are paying attention.
Yeah, I must say, I'm impressed. So, for this, we are going to apply a radial color. Nope. A gradient 2. So, I'm just...
Just gonna stop you just for a second because there's a question from Ryan. Can you give a quick explanation on the Max contest? And for those of you who don't know about the contest, we have a contest going on for the 3 days of this live stream, and we're already on day 2. So you have today and tomorrow to submit your artwork. And basically, let me just go to the contest page here. There's a button at the. Let me just see if. I'm just going to move to my screen in just a second. And this is going to be weird because there's a live stream going on as well. I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to stay here with Maria's polar grid drawing. Basically, what you need to do is to create an illustration or an animation based on the theme Max. Max can mean many things. It can mean many different things for anybody out there. Like Michael says, it could be the name of your cat. It could be maximum something. It could be creativity. It could be Max. Yes, it's
Max.
Just Max. Okay, and maybe Max is your name. So who knows? You know. And then basically, what we invite you to do is to share artwork created. For this Max contest to Instagram or Twitter using the hashtag Adobe Live. And you need to do that before October 20, 1 p.m. Pacific time, okay? 1 p.m. Pacific time. That's what time here? Well, I don't know. It doesn't matter. 1 p.m. Pacific time. And basically, the top 10 entries will be rewarded with a one-year Creative Cloud subscription. Okay, so there is a lot at stake here. There's not that many submissions yet, so there is a high chance to win. So please participate in our Adobe Max contest. And the question might be, why Max? Because in a couple of weeks in San Diego, we will have our yearly creativity conference called Adobe Max. And we have just under 10,000 people coming to that conference. 10,000 people.
That's
and
not...
Maria's coming too.
Yeah,
Maria's going to have a Rufus session.
Is coming.
Rufus is coming too. And Maria's going to have a session at Adobe Max. And I know there's over 600 people here registered for your session. Do you know how many that is? 600 people in a room?
I don't that's, want to know.
That's huge. Okay, so imagine that. There's 10,000 people coming. That's what? That's 6% of all the attendees in one room. Right?
That is so is that, cool.
Am I doing the math correctly here? I don't know, but anyway, that's a lot of people.
Yeah.
So basically, it's a three-day conference in San Diego. We will have keynotes. We will have keynotes presenting our vision for the future, the Adobe vision for the future. We will have also inspirational keynotes that we will actually broadcast here live on AdobeLife.com. So please subscribe to... There's a subscribe button. Subscribe to the AdobeLife.com, to the Creative Cloud channel. There's a button. It's so easy. Just click on it and subscribe. And the benefit of subscribing to the Creative Cloud channel is that you will know every time we will be live. Okay? And especially for Adobe Max, we will be live from the keynotes. We will be live also 8 hours a day, every day, from the Adobe Pavilion, where we will have guests, and it will be very similar to the 3 days we're experiencing here today from Paris with various guests. We have, how many guests do you have? Like 24? 25 different guests over the period of 3 days. So that will be super, super exciting. Adobe Max, okay? And so if you want to share your artwork and be inspired by Max, do that with the Adobe Live hashtag, either on Instagram or on Twitter, or both for that matter. And why don't we do a quick raffle here and raffle out a print of the little fellow.
Mm-hmm.
Little fellow.
Mm-hmm.
You're gonna have to Are you ready, Michael?
No, you need
I need Nightbot to work for me.
And a secret keyword.
I need a secret keyword, yes. Let's okay, so basically I'm gonna ask for a tool that Maria has been using. Okay, it's gonna be super easy for those of you who have been listening. One thing to know also is that if you subscribe to the Creative Cloud YouTube channel, which the button is down here, I always get it wrong, you have 5 times more opportunities to win. Okay, it doesn't mean that if you don't subscribe to the channel that you won't win, but there's more chances that you will win. Okay, so what I need you to do, Franck Payan says, don't pick me. No, I will not pick you, Franck. Actually, tell Nightbot to not consider Franck Payan. And basically, what I will ask you, let's just tweet about the tool that Maria has been using to create these incredible shapes. It's a tool.
It's a tool. It's a tool.
Oh, here we go. All right. And Steve is already saying it. Even though, like, probably it hasn't come to the... Yeah, there we go, the scallop tool. All right. Oh, scallop, warp and transform. Okay, oh. Valeria has been very attentive. Taking notes, maybe, Valeria? Let's see how many people will answer here. And let's leave that going for a couple of minutes. Okay. Oh, let's see. People are paying attention. Scallop, warp, polar grid.
That's impressive. That's
okay.
Good.
Yeah, we always start with an easy question. For the second print of this session, we will try to find something a little bit more complicated. But we don't want to make it difficult for you. All right, scallop tool. let's give them a couple more, like 30 seconds or so.
Yeah.
So basically what we're doing now, we use the polar grid to create the concentric circles, mm-hmm. and then use the scallop tool.
Yeah.
To actually recreate that that furry feeling from these circles.
Yeah, right? So you really can't tell that it's the polar grid that has been used originally.
You would not really know that these are circles.
No.
But they're not circles anymore, right?
No, if we go to outline view,
yeah, okay.
It is really...
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you can say that this is what you might call destructive. Mm-hmm. So
it is destructive, yes.
It's applied directly. Mm-hmm.
This is why Maria always recommends, if you're going to do something with the scallop tool, like if you want to go back, just make sure that you have a copy of your original artwork. Although maybe that, you know, using the polar grid tool is also kind of super easy too.
One thing I would recommend is you can save it in your library.
In the Creative Cloud libraries. Yeah. That's a very, very good idea. Basically, whatever you save in a Creative Cloud library, you will have access to from your mobile devices, from your Illustrator, from your Photoshop, from all other applications, so that you can actually work on it and import it and place it. So that's a very, very good idea. So if you care about your concentric circles and you want to use them multiple times, just put them into a Creative Cloud library. That's a very, very good tip. Okay, so let's stop the... and the winner is... And the winner is, okay, where's Nightbot? Do we have, I'm not seeing Nightbot. Kathy Tiska. All right, Kathy Tiska, you won a autographed by Maria Grönlund of The Little Fellow.
Yeah, congratulations.
Yes, congratulations, Kathy. Thank you for participating and thank you for watching the stream, every one of you. All right, let's go on with the head of Little Fellow.
Yeah. So, we are just using the Little Fellow as an example, but what I really want to, I hope to inspire you to do, to explore all these the tools, instead of just using the usual tools that, you know, we talked about yesterday. If you could rank the tools most used, probably the pen tool in top.
Yes, most
the
probably.
Number one.
Yeah.
And then a long distance, there would be some in the bottom. Mm-hmm.
Because if we zoom into this furry head there, these are potentially, 100 lines maybe? Maybe more.
I don't know.
So I can easily imagine somebody who doesn't know the technique with the, you know, the circles or lines and then the scallop tool, actually drawing 100 lines, you know, and then grouping it and then applying the. It just simplifies everything. Knowing about you know the tools and what they do.
It's cheating.
It's not cheating.
I know. It's a shortcut. Hey. So in principle, you can take the if we have a look at the tool section, there's let's see what it's called, rectangular grid tool.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, so you can make that too. That could also be used for
the rectangular grid tool. Yeah, how many times did I find myself making lines and then duplicating them and then rotating them and making that? Yeah, perfect.
So if you're double clicking, you can set how many subdivisions you want.
That's also another very good way to rapidly create a grid and use the Life Paint tool to make swatches or
that could be, or if you want. Maybe turn it into a guide, Shift Command F. So now the guides are hidden, but if we go to guides, show guides. What? Haven't turned into a guide. Guides. I don't know.
Because it was selected. Still.
So now it's a guide. Mm-hmm. And if you say snap to guide it, whatever you draw will snap to this.
Yep.
I'm going to undo. And under there's also a spiral tool. And same, you can double click on it.
This is something somebody mentioned yesterday when you were creating the Fibonacci, the Fibonacci sequence, the Fibonacci spiral. Why isn't she using the spiral tool? Because it's not the same kind of spiral, I don't think, right? It's like you can make a spiral, but
if you click on the artboard, you get this the pop-up menu where you can set, but I don't, maybe just me, but I find it difficult to values be. You can try numerous times and then you get the right result.
Yeah, yeah.
But yesterday I used the arc tool. And it calculates the correct curve for you, so I don't have to calculate which numbers are right.
Ah, that's just an idea here, using the polar grid, rectangle grid, and then doing the arches in there.
Ah, huh? I should have thought of that.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So we could have, I could have used the spiral for the head as well.
Mm-hmm. For, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, why not?
So, yeah, or the rectangular.
Yeah.
In the end, you can't see what
what the original shape
was. Yeah, I just want a lot of anchor points, so I have something to apply the scalp to. So we have a head for the little fellow. Let's move on. So, let's collect the head and the body. Just going back. Find, here it is. Not as perfect as what I intended to, because I used several times to figure out what the... here we are. So pasting in here the body, and I go back and paste the head as well. Copy and paste and place it over here. And we want the head
in front.
Yeah, control click and bring to front. Not, maybe it's because of the layers. I'm going to put it on the test layer. There we go. So,
yes.
Yeah. Yeah, make sure to, when the body is finished and when the head is finished, to group, so you don't have to move. It's easier to select and move. I'm going to group this as well, so I can...
can give the head a direction.
Yeah. So, well, the eyes, really just press the L and you've got an eye. D. So. A couple of eyes here. And with no white stroke. So just a little detail when you're zooming with the zoom tool, when we are in the regular preview mode, you can do this click and drag zoom.
The scrubby zoom.
Yeah, that's really cool. Something I noticed when you're in outline view, it's not possible.
Ah.
So just go to regular preview if you want to do that. And copy the eye, and yeah, make a.
Steve said it might make a nice fly fishing lure.
Yeah, yeah. For a virtual digital fish.
Jan Udermann, Maria Grönlund is from Denmark. So yes, it was quite some travel here to come to Paris, right? You have to take two planes.
From
Denmark.
And
Ryan said it's so simple, but I learned so many techniques. Yep. That's the whole point of these live streams, right? Yeah. To let you guys see how, you know, other people work.
Yeah, and it's a really good way of learning.
Mm-hmm.
It's one thing I noticed when I attended graphic design education was when we got an assignment, you got a description of a project that the teacher wanted you to do, and in the end the teacher expected all the students to have exactly the same result.
The same result. So
sad. There's no no improvising or experimentation. Mm-hmm. So when you're learning this way, you're going sort of off-road and trying all sorts of things.
Yeah.
I think it's a very good way of
learning. Yeah, this changed so much because when I studied design, that was in like late 80s and early 90s. I graduated in 92. Of course, there was no internet. The only resource that we had to learn, like, to see new techniques, to see new designs, was the library. You know, and design school libraries had to be good at that time because, you know, we had to have all the latest magazines, all the latest books. Very expensive for the school to maintain these libraries, but that was the only way that we could learn. And of course, our teachers. And the teachers, you know, needed to be very, very close to the market, to the to what was happening in the world. So I guess it was also, maybe it was more difficult to teach at that time, because now we know with the inspiration coming from so many different places. Maybe the thing that we need to learn is to how to navigate through the noise and find the good stuff. You know.
Mm. Mm.
All right, sorry, I was divagating.
No. So, this way of learning really has changed the trajectory, I think, of my career.
Mm-hmm.
So you might think, does it matter how you're learning?
Mm-hmm.
If you're learning, it's the same tools, it's the same program.
Mm-hmm.
Why should it change how you learn it?
Mm-hmm.
But it really does, because you're... there's sort of no hierarchy of what's the correct or the best and what you should learn first or next.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
So you easily get into these kind of nerdy corners of Illustrator that's really interesting, and you can create results that maybe no other graphic designer
Very
has
unexpected
done before.
Things.
Yeah. And that's exactly the base for all my tutorials you find on Behance. Is when I find these surprising results.
Mm-hmm.
I think, must share. So, let's just give the little fellow some feelers. Mm.
Nicolas Aguirre is asking, will Maria be doing something like her Colorscapes project with gradient meshes?
That was wild.
Yeah.
That was actually a friend asking me, I wonder what would happen if you just went crazy with Illustrator.
Yeah. Let's go crazy.
Let's go crazy.
So Shivam, you're asking this question many times. Like, Maria, can you tell us how to make pop art, like using colors for shadows and highlights instead of shades and tints? I don't really understand the question. I don't know if it's on topic. Do you understand the question?
Yeah. One thing, pop art.
Hmm.
Up art, optical art, or pop art?
I don't know. Let's see if Shivam can.
So we can take.
Be a little bit more precise.
Very fast detour here. Not too long. So let's just say we've learned to use a live paint tool.
Ah, yes.
Yeah. Let's make some optical art. Go fill in. The father of the op art was Victor Vasarely back in the 60s. I think he wrote a manifest or something about op art. So, yeah. One thing about op art is you sort of distort the make an optical illusion of some kind, and it's often using just these bright colors as what he mentioned, I can't recall the name, but
yeah, colorful shadows and highlights instead of shades and tints.
Yeah, so that's just, we're exploring the warp tool section here today, right? So another tool is the bloat tool here in the same section. So if I wanted to explore this, combining with the rectangular tool, I could set, let's just say 150. Ooh. Also here. Let's make some upward. So I'm going to click in the middle here. Oh, it's too much. It's just set. Yeah, be careful with the intensity and the details. See if I can do it more gently. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How many drawings like these have I done with ink and like curvy rulers, you know?
Calculating.
Yeah.
So this would be typical Victor Vasarely art. He painted it by hand, also, of course.
And there, I mean, for Shivam's question, there you could use the coloring tools, of course, and give the various colors, and then use the color replacement tools to change the hues and the contrasts of the various colors. So if you want to see a little bit more about that, we went through some of these tools yesterday with Maria. So
we're making Victor Vasarely art, up art here. Very easy.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, just using the pencil tool for the fields, really. Nothing new here. Just not.
Oh, not the antennas.
Antennas, yeah.
There you could use the arc tool.
Yeah.
Right?
Of course you could. It depends on what result you will like. Mm-hmm. So the arch tool is precise, sort of very mathematical. It's sort of a perfect curve. And if you want to make some it's an animal to really like a more organic appearance, and then using the pencil tool will add some imperfection to look a bit more.
And you know, the pencil tool has become my new best friend since if you double click on it, on the tool itself, in the options, you can actually change the fidelity, okay? Because everybody hated, including me, the pencil tool when, you know, there was no fidelity. So if you say, if you go to accurate all the way there and draw something with the pencil tool, this is how the pencil tool would draw, okay? And it's not precise at all. It's got like a gazillion points. It's not precise. But
there's a lot of details.
Yes.
If you would like a lot of details on your stroke, that would be.
Yes, but it's not even. I mean, if you zoom in, it's not even. You see,
it's a bit clumsy.
It's very clumsy, and that's why nobody used the pencil tool before, because it was too clumsy.
Yeah.
Now that you can adjust the fidelity. And something like if it's super smooth, it's maybe a bit too smooth, but let's put it there. Basically, it corrects any stroke you do and actually makes the curves more perfect. So, yes, very good tool.
That's nice. Yeah, so please excuse the little rough result here. So you can spend a lot of time of trying and undoing and trying again to get the result you would like. So I'm just taking the body and copy it, make a copy of it, because it looks a little bit short. And you can go to transform and say we would like to flip it horizontal, so it fits, and maybe rotate it a bit so it looks like one long body that fits together, and paste it in back. So right now the gradient is Yeah, it's obvious. It's two. It's two elements, two groups. And let's see if I can change the X. No, yeah. So right now, the gradient that is applied to each group, it starts one end and ends exactly where the mm-hmm. it stops. So if I go to object and expand it, the strokes, expand the strokes. Let's see what that would look like.
This gradient here is very fashionable right now, right? This gradient hair?
Yeah.
There's even a name for that, right?
Yeah, hairdresser designers as well. Yeah. So it looks exactly the same, but I've expanded the strokes because now I can alter where the gradients start and where it ends. Let's just expand the other body part as well. Object, expand, and it's the strokes we want to expand. So we click OK, now it's fill. Looks exactly the same. In this view, if we go to outline view, you can see it's, the stroke is outlined. If I undo, go back, say undo, you can see it looks very thin, all the strokes.
Mm-hmm.
If you set redo, you can see it's now expanded. So what I want is the gradient to go from one end of the body to the, so stretch it out so it fills the entire body. So I've selected both. I hide the selection, Command H, and I just click. You can see that's the length of the gradient, and I want it to end right where the head is. So now we have the green in this end and the red and the gray.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I hope it makes sense. So do ask if you have questions.
Yes. Are there any questions out there for Maria's technique here? Let's see.
Yeah. So we are. So now I finished the little fellow, and so when I made this was new to me. I thought that's interesting. It must be possible to make something different. And you go, what could it look like? This it could look like fur, but it could also look like a feather.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe if you altered it a bit. So. One of the things I did with this, I've done with this learning process, is to go through many iterations of the same tool combinations to see. So I can make fur. I wonder if I could make a feather also. So same tool combinations, looking for new results.
Okay.
Yeah. So I've made it looks almost like the base for a head.
This. Ana Uribe is asking, sorry, why did you expand the stroke again?
Should I do that?
No, why did you expand the stroke again?
Oh, yeah. Let's just go back. It's because... let me see how to phrase that. It's when the gradient is applied to a stroke, you can't decide where you want the gradient to start and stop.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just select this one. Right now, if I press G and click and drag, I can decide I want the gradient, the green, to start right here and end here.
Yes, so you see the difference, right?
You stretch the green out to fill almost half of
it. And this you can't do on a stroke?
No.
Okay, this is why we expanded the stroke.
Yeah.
I hope that makes sense, Ana Uribe. Yevano. I think you don't pronounce the L, right?
Sure.
So Helmia says, I want to learn illustration. Yep. And like we said with Dan Mumford before, it's practice, practice, practice.
Yeah. Yeah. So, what I did, I just took the bass for a head from the fiddle, mm-hmm. and set out to try something different. It's basically the polar grid again.
Okay.
And just applying scales.
The circular one, yeah, or?
Yeah. This. The polar here. Yeah. No reason to show that again. I think we got the point. So. I take the copy of the element. No, I clip. And then. Did I get it? No. Just going back, maybe it's B. For some reason I can't. I don't know why. I could go to updates. It's there. Ah, it's locked.
The layer.
My weird. Copy and paste it into the onto the next artboard. There you go. And I'm going to make 6 copies and place it like a fan.
Mm-hmm.
So it starts to look a bit like a feather, which was the result I'm going for. So let's just copy. So just a minor warning here, as we start to copy this very detailed object, it's going to be a bit heavy, you're more copy.
Okay.
We've got many anchor points here.
We're going to hear the fan from your computer going vroom.
Yeah. So. Oh, I don't know why I can't do that.
Valeria Sassi, if you want to share something with us, please use the Adobe Live hashtag on Twitter. Did you create a little fellow that you want to share with us? That would be cool.
Hey, if you all click, now if you choose the rotate tool, hit the R on the keyboard and press Alt and click in the bottom of the shape, you should get the rotate pop up, so you can, One of the good things about this is you can copy. Let's say we want it here, and when I say copy, you have the original and a copy.
Mm-hmm.
Voila. And you can, yeah, it was too much, but I think you get the point. So maybe I'm going to be. And then copy this, all 3. I'm not used to using the trackpad, so please be patient with me. So there you go. There's the spinning pizza. You don't want to see, but
it's called the spinning beach ball of death.
Beach ball.
Yes.
All right. Maria's house, it's a pizza.
The pizza, okay. Very colorful pizza.
Yeah. Even our pizzas are colorful. So. Yep. Let's just see if I can. Yeah. So you can expect it to pop up a lot of times.
Yeah. Okay.
Especially because I'm using a laptop. Mm-hmm. If I had a larger computer,
yes,
it would not be the same problem.
As long as it doesn't crash on us. Oh, oh, something happened. Oh, there we go. Okay.
Yeah.
So. Yes, because this is a lot of information right there.
Yeah, it is.
A lot of points. Does it tell you in the information if selected a second?
The
and
info?
If you go and you go in the info panel, it should actually tell us how many points. Shouldn't it? If you go in the more information, show options. No.
There was a way. I don't
there
remember.
Is a script. You can a free script.
Okay.
Where
to count points.
Count selected anchor points. Mm. Yeah.
So you remember in the old days of PostScript printing, where the printer didn't have a lot of memory, and every point was actually more PostScript information. Mm. And when we had very complicated illustrations, like stuff like that, it would most probably crash the printer. And so we always had to export images like that as TIFFs, or you know, like
pixel
rasterize them. Yeah. Which is not the case anymore. So that's good.
So I want to apply a gradient now. Make sure to ungroup. I'm not sure I'm going to finish it further. I just give you a hint of how it can be made, so you don't have to wait too long. But it should be ungrouped, totally ungrouped now, so I can apply a gradient. Let's see what that will look like.
Oh, yes, here's the beach. Here's the beach ball of death.
Yeah.
And usually what I do is when the beach ball comes up, I don't know if your computer can do that, but I zoom in and I have the beach ball fill the whole screen so that people get hypnotized.
There's no reason to I hope you get the picture that you can can reduce.
Document info panel.
Document info.
We can't do it. There's a spinning beach ball. So there's nothing we can do when the spinning beach ball is here. Nice.
Yeah, I would have applied it to the fill. I forgot to put the fill in front. I'm not going to do it because we don't want
more beach balls. Yeah. So document info, where is there's probably file.
Under file.
Yeah. File.
Document.
No. File info, maybe?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So let's see if there's anything. Nah, it's not here. Maybe. I don't know.
No. But I know that.
Can't go to the document info panel and then select object on the more option on the side of the panel.
Object. Okay. No.
Maybe because it's a group. I don't know. But it should be in there. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Anyway. Oh. Let's not do that. Oh, no. We need to go to Window, Document Info. Okay, let's do
that. Window. Document Info. That was.
That is cool. Here we go.
Yeah.
Now, artboard dimensions. And then we need to go to the menu and say objects, right? Yes, object. The second one. And no. It doesn't say there. But anyway, okay. We get it. We potentially can know the number of but
gradient objects 117.
Gradient objects. Oh, sorry, it's 117 objects, but that's not really the points.
No.
But it's still a lot of objects.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Do you know the number of points?
Yeah.
Points?
Yeah.
Go to object path simplify.
Ah, there you go. That's a good, very good tip. Thank you, Michael.
Path simplify. Yeah.
And there.
Yeah. I forgot that one.
Uh-oh.
I didn't do that.
Do you have a spinning wheel?
Not yet, but it will come very soon.
I can predict it. Da-da-da, that da-da-da. Was arriving just as predicted.
No.
Yeah, what did you make us do, Michael?
I wanted to know the number of points.
Yeah, let's...
Uh-oh.
Can we escape out of that?
No.
Let's believe. Maybe you have some entries on Adobe.
This guy.
Maybe on Twitter you have some.
Yes.
Design to review.
Yes. Let's see if we have some artwork here on Twitter to look at. Let me just update the page. Oh,
original current. So you have
19,820 points.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's a perfectly good reason why it's so heavy to calculate for the computer.
Maybe that's right.
Yeah, I was going. The plan was to copy six of those, and so
okay.
Not going to do that.
Let's not do that.
No.
Okay. All right. Let's just continue with the feather.
Yeah. Even the cancel is slow now.
Okay.
Oh, do we have some pictures to?
Yes. Let's see. Let's see what we have here. And let's transition to my screen a second. All right, so this is what Valeria submitted. So
that
I guess there's a lot of transformations
beautiful.
There.
Yeah. Hmm? Fractal. Fractal art.
Yeah, right. It almost looks fractal, like with the gradients and.
Yeah.
Interesting. Then we have.
Those turrets. Yeah.
How did you do that? Click.
I do believe he made a tutorial that
okay.
You can go to his portfolio
okay.
on Behance.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's a link to the tutorial.
Yeah.
Experiment.
Please
with,
do okay. go and see it. It's awesome.
And what else do we have here?
Wow.
Abstract art from
that's
Tanzim.
Amazing. That's also
7 minutes ago.
Kind of optical art also.
Mm-hmm. That's. Did you do that in Illustrator Tanzim? Oh wow! Is it? Photography.
The
it almost looks like photography.
The warp tool under same, same section we've explored. There's this
finger painting tool
called warp tool.
Mm-hmm.
If you make color and you can sort of smudge.
Nice.
To get this effect. Again, it's something you have be careful because
it's
very
a,
fast.
You
it's getting really
powerful machines.
Heavy, yeah.
Powerful machines.
Yeah.
This is a drawing by Rohit.
Wow.
That's for Adobe Max. Okay, so we'll be reviewing those.
Oh, okay.
Oh, here's a link to the tutorial again. Yeah, we had a monogram yesterday as well, right? Like, okay, interesting.
The radial, the polar grid.
Yep. Hey, we can see the grid in the back.
Yeah,
this
so
year.
You get the perfect distance between the circles. It's the precise distance.
That also,
yeah.
Right? To get the perfect distance between.
Yeah.
Duh! I never thought of that. Photography negative space. It's a nice icon logo.
Yeah, great idea.
It's Maite. That's Dan.
Yeah.
No, it looks like Dan, but could be Dan. I don't know. Anyway, and then
same
we go
glasses,
back to Dan. Okay.
Glasses, yeah.
Let's go back to your work.
So, yeah, if you apply a radial gradient to each of the groups, the six groups, and place them in a fan, four of these, it's getting heavy. But if you have a big computer is not a problem, then you can get a result like this. It almost looked like a photorealistic feather.
It does.
The only thing you need is a quill in the end.
Is? The quill, yes.
But zero. So, yeah, you can use a pen tool just to make the basic shape for the quill. And apply a gradient to the field, and I've applied a mask. So when you have the quill selected, you can just say add mask, and then it will create. Yeah, if you click on this to the right from the preview,
that's the mask.
That's the mask, yeah. And now it's when. It's black, it's covering on, unless you say invert mask, if we do that, then, so, yeah.
Yes,
everything
so
is
white
is visible.
White shows and black covers.
Yes, and everything in between, all the grayscales, you can make percentage of mm-hmm. how much you want it to be visible.
Okay, so like a gradient, for example.
Yeah, mm. yeah. So we're using a gradient here. Make sure that the object you want to apply a mask to is selected, and click on the mask to the right. And then you can, let's add a gradient. Where do I have my gradient palette? It's here. Let's see, I think that's a default. No. So I'm going to make one. So we want the black to cover.
Mm-hmm.
And we want the white where we want things to be shown. And be sure so this black, if you go to RGB, you can see it's not totally black, mm. it's almost black. So you can just click on the black down here and it's
okay.
fully mm. black.
Just to make sure.
Yeah. And so I'm rotating this. And again, because the gradient is applied to the fill, I can decide when I hit the G on the keyboard, I get the gradient. I can decide where I want the gradient to start mm-hmm. and stop. So I want it to start at the top of the quill and just a little bit down. So yeah, just the opposite, of course, like this. So it's fading out the quill. So it looks more natural, just like we have. And remember now, if you try to do something like drawing with the pencils and you, what? It's disappearing. What's going on? Then check your transparency palette, because we are now in mm. the mask. So click to the left.
This is a good trick to troll your coworkers, right?
Yeah.
You just create a layer mask.
Oh, that's yeah. So yeah, if I was drawing now, so you can see. That is. So we have a quill for the feather, and it's just
wow.
Yeah. So this is and you know, when you get a result like this, I think you know, what can I do? Mm-hmm. Make an alternative version again. You know, mm-hmm. keep making many iterations of the same mm-hmm. idea. Just.
Did you add a drop shadow here as well to the
yeah,
group?
Yeah, yeah. Mm. Because now. It really starts to look like photorealistic, mm-hmm. and we are still in Illustrator.
Yeah,
it's something you would expect,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
at least not as a beginner.
Can we zoom in a second, just see a little bit of the detail?
Yes, but this is a rasterized because
it's so
heavy. So
yeah. Okay, no problem.
Yeah,
we don't want to see the spinning beach ball.
No. So what the gradient I've applied, you can see it over here in the gradient panel. We just
mm-hmm.
So
did you make that gradient, or is this inspired by something? Did you observe a bird to make that feather, or just make it up?
Yeah,
is it imaginary?
Google feathers mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. see. So I really wanted it to look natural.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, what brown shades yes. would a feather have? You can also, you
this
know,
this is awesome.
Yeah, mm-hmm. one mentioned making a peacock.
Mm-hmm.
So. Then you would use brown and green and violet. And even, you know, I gave it a try with the white.
Oh,
and
wow,
you, of
nice.
Course, you have to alter the background so you can see
mm-hmm,
it.
Mm-hmm.
And try to, when you've made the feather, you can use, we saw the warp tool. One mm-hmm. has used the warp tool for his optical art. You can also.
Oh, the Ooh. Giveaway! Michael just entered the room and is screaming, giveaway! Okay. So, let me think what we could ask.
Her country?
Yeah.
Yes?
That's slightly, nice. A little bit difficult.
A little bit.
Yeah.
Yes?
Very tiny, tiny country.
Yes? Okay. Yeah, we want to know, where is Maria Grönlund from? Okay, and that... You have to put that
in the chat. Why should they put? What can they win?
Yes, the giveaway. Yeah, giveaway. interrogation mark. Yes, of course. The giveaway is will be a print from with that will include the little fellow and a feather, right? For yeah, printed on high quality paper and autographed by Maria herself. Yes. So that is the prize. Oh wow, we have everybody's got it. Everybody's but you know, this is actually a good sign because it means all these people have been sticking with us. You guys are awesome. Yes, Denmark for the win. All right. And yeah, so basically just so that we you know, we're just to recap a second. If you're watching this on YouTube, you're missing out. Come to adobelive.com and get the full experience of the Adobe Live, because here we have the chat, we have the schedule in a pod, we have access to all of the replays. Actually, if you missed the beginning of Maria's talk right now, you will find the replay in just
20 minutes.
In 20 minutes, there will already be the replay there. And of course, there's the replay from yesterday. And you can watch the replays when you go home.
Yeah. But
are you, do you watch things that you've done? Like, I don't like watching, you know, stuff that I've done. But anyway, so yeah, so there's the replays. There's a tab for the speakers where there's more information about the speakers that we've invited. And of course, the tab for the 3-day contest. We are on day 2 today. And the 3-day contest is based on the theme Max. Why Max, would you ask, of course? Because in 2 weeks, we have our big creativity conference in San Diego in California, and it's called Adobe Max. Okay, so Max can mean anything. Can mean anything to you. It could be, you know, like, what does Max mean to you? Okay, that's what we want to know here. And Maria will be joining us at Max as well, and we will be streaming from Max. And maybe you will visit us on our booth, maybe at Max, like our streaming booth. Like, for are we planning that, Michael? Is Maria being invited to the?
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay. So Maria is coming for a session, and yeah, Adobe Max is huge. We're going to have just under 10,000 people there, maybe even over, I don't know, but it's like, no, not more than 10,000. Okay, Michael says no, but like, yeah, crazy stuff. And Maria's session already has more than 600 people like that want to get into the session. So we're going to have to get a huge room for you, Maria.
Close the doors.
Yes, close the doors. No more people can come in. And
okay,
the
Nightbot.
Oh, Nightbot. Nightbot got a winner for us.
Maria Francesca Girelli.
That is awesome. Maria Francesca has been interacting with us quite a bit today. She's in the fashion industry. And she gave us that good tip about, you know, making the skirt designs for the
polar grid.
So Maria, congrats. Maria Francesca, please reach out to Michael on his Twitter account, mchez, at mchez. He's going to put it right here in the chat anyway, to get more information about how to claim your prize. Okay, so congratulations. Wow. So yeah, so we're saying about Adobe Max, we will be streaming a whole bunch of stuff. We will be streaming from a special streaming booth that we're preparing. We're going to be streaming about 8 hours of content a day. We have over 20 guests that we will be interviewing and meeting during these 3 days of Adobe Max. And also very important, we will be streaming here on adobelive.com all of the keynotes. So we have keynotes about, you know, the future, the vision of Adobe, where the technology is going, and what's happening on that front. And then, of course, we also have keynotes that are inspiring with inspiring speakers. We have Quentin Tarantino in one of our keynotes. Mm. Yeah, so that's gonna be interesting. So yes, so please join us also for Adobe Max in a couple of weeks. If you want to be alerted about you know, what's happening. Down here, I got it right.
Yeah.
No, down here, there's a subscribe button. Subscribe to the channel to always be informed about when we go live. And also here on AdobeLife.com, as soon as we can, we will be updating the schedule for Adobe Max. So you can also like have a look at the schedule and see exactly what's coming. But now, for the last 5 minutes, let's go back to you, Maria, and just wrap it up. Okay?
Sum it up.
What have we done today?
Yeah, so we have explored the scallop tool.
Mm-hmm. And the scallop tool.
Scallop
yes.
tool.
Such a weird name, but such a powerful tool. Yes.
It's really fun to use, and you can apply it to all sorts of strokes.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're a little bit lazier, if you want to be efficient and very fast, you can use various drawing tools. We've explored the polar grid tool. You can use a transform tool to make multiple strokes very fast copy. And go explore more of the stroke tools, the rectangular tool, the spiral tool. So,
So now all that's missing is to put the little fellow and a feather on
a piece of
a sheet,
yeah.
Yes, and let's have that printed for our two lucky winners today. So let's see if there's any last minute questions before we stop the stream. And of course, our next guest, James Curran, is James here already? James Curran will continue working on creating animated GIFs / animated GIFs using After Effects and Photoshop. Does he use Photoshop as well a little bit? No, just After Effects. Just After Effects. Animated GIFs or GIFs. I don't want to go into the debate of how you say it anymore.
No.
Because it's a very heated debate. Do you ever try to tweet?
I avoid saying it, just writing it.
You're just worried about saying it, right? Okay, Cedric wants to go to Max next year. Maybe next year. I want to go to Max, but maybe next year. Awesome, Cedric. Mm. Ryan, your boy Quentin. And look at the Twitter tags again. Now we don't have, let's see if I can find your, I refreshed it. Shivam, are you coffee caffeine?
Yes. Yeah, so.
Okay, yes, all right. Okay, so let's look at this.
Yeah.
This piece from Shivan. I updated the page just for you. Let's see. Three and let's boom. Change the screen to this illustration. So this was done in Illustrator, I guess.
Amazing.
And maybe if you want to give us a little bit more insight, Shivan, about this drawing. It's amazing, yeah, because I mean there's a lot of gradients happening here, a little light.
Looks like a galaxy.
Yeah, like an explosion of light.
Yeah.
Yes, it's all done in Illustrator, Shivam says.
Super cool.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Hmm? What can we say? Maria.
Yes.
What will we be doing tomorrow?
Good questions.
Do you have any?
I don't know.
You don't know?
Nope,
awesome.
Don't
that's the best answer. So yes, because yesterday we've been using the Fibonacci sequence to create a very geometrical kind of drawing, but still using gradients. So people have asked in the chat as well, like, you know, if you can go over, you know, the I speak fluid colors kind of thing, like, you know, this kind of gradient meshes. What is it?
It's actually
blending objects,
applied effects in Photoshop.
Yes, maybe even if you were not planning, or maybe just a quick section just on like creating this type of drawing. So I know there's quite a few people who have asked about that.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was saying yesterday we worked with a Fibonacci sequence to create a geometrical bird.
Mm-hmm.
Right,
yeah,
the bee eater.
The
we
bee
used
eater,
the life painting tools, and today we've discovered the scallop tool. So, my friends, this is it for now. Stay here on AdobeLife.com. In 5 minutes, we will be back with James Curran, working on animated GIFs. All right, bye.